Here in Tennessee, the emerald ash borer is increasingly becoming a huge problem locally and across the nation. So we're gonna talk to some experts about some things you really need to know. So it's currently here, there's no denying this.
There's no denying it. It's sweeping across the state, all the way from East Tennessee, and it's reached Middle Tennessee into Davidson County. It was first detected in Davidson County a couple of years ago in the northeastern part, okay. And they're monitoring it. But the trend for the emerald ash borer is that once it's detected, it takes a few years, and then all of a sudden you have a major outbreak. So we're probably within just a year or two are seeing something pretty significant.
Wow, so once it's detected, it's a rapid increase.
It's kind of like a tidal wave. It has to build up a little momentum, but once it gets going, there's nothing that can stop it.
So there's nothing that we can do about it.
Not about the pest itself. It's gonna happen. It's a invasive species from China.
Sure.
That just did not co-evolve with the trees, the ash trees we have here. So The ash trees are pretty much left defenseless. And once the EAB gets a foothold, they normally just last a couple of years before dying.
Yeah, yeah. Well, as far as catching up, what specifically can a homeowner do?
Well, it's got to be a collaborative effort working with the government, the private sector, and homeowners, and all kinds of folks. And you really need to get their act together, but homeowners are a key. Mm-hmm. And I would say the number one thing, especially in areas that are impacted by the EAB or that are going to be impacted, is that homeowners educate themselves on the emerald ash borer. There's a lot of good information online, websites at Extension and all sorts of places. Mm-hmm. But if you've got an ash tree in your yard, you need to learn about this pest and learn what's going to happen to your tree and then determine your options. Do you want to remove the tree now when it's probably going to be easier and less costly to do it? Mm-hmm. Or do you want to find a significant ash? Maybe you have one that's very special. Mm-hmm. And you want to invest some money in applying some insecticides. There are some treatments there that can help you maintain a healthy ash tree.
Okay.
But that's about all your options unless the tree dies. You definitely want to replace with another tree, but
those are about
all the options they have.
So one important thing is to, you know, identification. Make sure that you know that you're working with an ash tree. How does somebody know that they've got an ash tree?
Once again, there's all worlds of information on the web. Various agencies, I would advise folks to tap into that, maybe buy a book on tree identification. Uh-huh. But real simply, ash trees have some distinctive features. This is actually the leaf of an ash tree, and these are leaflets. You want to look for leaflets that are shaped like this, and most ash species have between 5 and 11 leaflets, and the one on the tip is usually the biggest, and they are all generally pointed. The distinctive part about an ash tree, because there's a lot of other trees that have compound leaves, uh-huh. is the arrangement of the leaflet.
Okay.
And I don't have another leaf here, but they are arranged opposite, what's called opposite of each other.
Mm-hmm.
So you can look at an ash tree, and if you see that the leaflet is coming off of a stem opposite another one, then that's a pretty good clue. That really narrows down that you have an ash tree.
Okay.
Now the reason this is important is there's other trees that have compound leaves that are arranged alternately,
okay.
like the hickory. It doesn't send the leaflets opposite each other, but they kind of are staggered like stair steps.
Uh-huh.
And I want to really emphasize that because you want to make sure that when you have somebody come by to take down what you think is an ash tree, it may be a hickory,
yeah.
which is fine. Make sure you have an ash tree, and there's a lot of information out there for homeowners to really make that decision themselves or to call for backup to help them identify that tree.
Sure, sure. So speaking of backing up a little bit, tell me a little bit about the history of this problem. You know, when did it start? Where did it start?
Well, they're piecing information together to kind of figure out how it got here. They think they know where it started in Detroit, Michigan. They believe it may have come in the mid-90s on some shipping crates from China. But due to the characteristics and nature of EAB, it takes a while for it to really develop enough of a population to show death and dieback and mortality of trees. Anyway, that happened in about 2001 or two,
okay.
I believe.
Is when we identified
the
problem.
They first saw the dieback in ashes. They didn't know what it was. And it took them a little while to figure out that it was the emerald ash borer.
And I mean, that's only roughly 25 years ago, and it's spread across the country in 25 years.
It has spread across the Northeast, the Central Lake areas, down the Eastern Coast, as far as Tennessee into Georgia. Mm-hmm. And now it's kind of making its way in a slow crawl, but a steady crawl towards the west.
What's the fastest way it spread?
Well, we can blame ourselves for that. But the beetle, the borer itself, it only flies like a half a mile from a tree. But the biggest cause or vector for the beetle's spread has been through people buying sawwood or cutting or logs for firewood. For fires and taking them across state lines to a campground, selling wood products that are made out of ash trees and sending those, even nursery stock that was ash trees, was sent before they really figured out what was going on.
I'm here with Scott Johnson. He's a board certified master arborist. And so if you have a really nice ash tree in your yard and it's something you do want to keep and maintain, what are some steps you can take to do that?
Well, I think the first step is identifying whether you do have a valuable ash tree in your yard. It's not really realistic to preserve every ash tree in your yard.
Sure.
Trees like this that add value to the property, trees in the front yard or trees that are over patios, trees that have some type of aesthetic appeal to the property, those would be ones that a homeowner might consider preserving at that point. If you have ash trees back on a back fence row or multiple ash trees around a tree, a more specimen oak tree or maple tree, it might be better just to remove those trees and let nature take its course.
Sure.
A tree like this that is a decent size, kind of a focal point in the front yard, there's some options for treatment and preservation. The main thing a homeowner needs to be aware of though, it's a long-term commitment.
Sure.
Once they start trying to preserve these trees, the insecticide treatment needs to be administered every year or every other year with the current chemistry. So they need to decide whether the value of the tree outweighs the cost of the preservation. And there's a lot of good cost calculators online to help determine that. This particular tree, in general, what you do is you determine the diameter of the tree, then the amount of insecticide applied is determined by the diameter inches of the trunk of the tree.
Okay.
There's several different options. The two most common are injecting the chemical into the soil and it's taken up systemically into the tree. That provides 1 year worth of protection with the current chemistry. There's another option where you can inject the chemical directly into the trunk of the tree and that can provide 2 years worth of protection. But the homeowner, if they take on this responsibility and this task, they need to be aware that this is something that's going to affect their budget year after year.
Sure, sure. When is the best time to do these treatments?
Generally when the sap starts flowing in the spring. You can do them throughout the summer if needed, but the best time to do it is that early spring once the sap starts flowing, because both options are systemic. They're injected in the trunk and taken up into the foliage of the tree. That way the entire tree system has the insecticide in it.
Yeah, it has that protection.
So what we know about the EAB and how it's spread across the country, these cities that have been infested before, the cities in Middle Tennessee, all the ash trees that have not been preventively treated in those cities have died. So you have a very short window. They say there's a mortality curve, and once the emerald ash borer has been detected, it takes 4, 5, 6 years for the populations to build. Once it hits that 5, 6, 7 year window, that's when you start seeing mass mortality of these emerald ash borer trees.
Mm-hmm.
It's unlikely the tree will uproot and fall over, but a lot of the big scaffold branches will start to dry out and start to fall down on personal property. So it's definitely something that property owners need to be aware of.
Yeah, great.
Once you start having about 30% thinning up in the canopy, it's too late. The bug starts attacking the tree and the upper part. A lot of times you can't even notice that the tree has been infected, infested with the bug. You start seeing that the thinning up in the top of the canopy, and once it reaches that 30% mark, there's no going back. The homeowner is basically wasting their money if they do try to preserve at that point. Some of the symptoms to watch for to see if your tree is infested, obviously that normal dieback up in the canopy. There are epicormic shoots or water sprouts that start growing on the trunk where the tree is trying to produce energy for itself.
Sure.
D-shaped emergent holes where the bug actually comes out of the tree and exits its life cycle within the tree. Also woodpecker damage. Woodpeckers will get up in the canopy and try to munch on the larva during that life cycle.
Yeah. So a very important thing too is making sure you get a certified arborist in your local area that really knows what they're doing, so they can, you know, correctly identify what's going on and make the correct steps.
Absolutely. With the type of investment homeowners are going to have to make to try to preserve these trees, they need to make sure they have a reputable company that's on their side, somebody that is insured and bonded, somebody that's been around for a while. In other parts of the country, some folks will chase this bug around knowing that there's going to be a lot of tree removals on the backside of an infestation. Make sure you're working with somebody that you trust that's been in your community for a while. Sure. If they have a certified arborist on staff, even better.
Well, some very good information on a scary thing that's happening in our area. I appreciate your time and your information, and I hope everybody takes these comments seriously, because it's in everybody's backyard. It's here and it's coming quickly. So thanks again.
Thank you.
For inspiring garden tours, growing tips, and garden projects, visit our website at volunteergardener.org or on YouTube at the Volunteer Gardener channel, and like us on Facebook.